Continuing with the proofs of various statements that we have postponed. So now let us take one by one. This is one of the important results, namely accession theorem for singular homology. Okay, so this is central to our theme. Singular homology is central to our whole theme. So what is accession? If X is union of two subspaces X1 and X2 such that their interiors X1 and X2 interiors of that cover the whole space, then X1 and X2 is an excessive couple. In particular, if X1 and X2 are open, then this will be automatically satisfied, then it will be excessive couple is obvious once from we have proved this one. So often what you may get is not exactly open subsets, but their interiors themselves cover, this is good enough is for this chair. So this is a very, very useful statement. Okay. So what is the meaning of accession? You take the subspace, the subchain complex, namely S dot X1 plus S of X2, inclusion map into the whole of S of X. Okay. Take that map induced by the inclusion on the homology H star of this to H star of X. This H star of X is nothing but H star of S dot X, the full chain complex, singular chain complex. We want to show that this is an isomorphism. Okay, this is a bijection. That's what we want to show. Given any singular n simplex, one of the generators for the chain complex here, say sigma is from mod delta into X. Remember, X is written as interior of X1 in interior of X2. Take the inverse image of these open subsets. Okay, they will give you two open subsets in mod delta n, which will cover mod delta n. And mod delta n is a compact thing. Whenever you have an open cover by a compact metric space, you have your Lebesgue number and so on. Once you have a Lebesgue number, you can cut down this delta n by barycentric subdivisions as often as you want, so that the final pieces will be all as small as you want. Small means diameter smaller. So putting all these together, I mean, I'm just recalling the proofs of various statements here in short. What you get is an iterated subdivision. SD, remember, is the barycentric subdivision. Power k is, it is repeated k times of delta n. Okay, each star of each vertex. Okay, if you take star of each vertex, that will be contained in either this open set or in that open set. That is meaning of finer than this covering. So SD of K denotes, now capital SD denotes, remember we have already introduced this. This is the subdivision chain map. This little SD is the operation of cutting down. This is a barycentric subdivision. This is the subdivision chain map. You take the composite of this chain map with itself k times, that is SD capital K. So what we have proved is that capital SD induces the same isomorphism, same identity isomorphism on the homology. Okay. So it follows that the singular n chain st k of sigma belongs to the subgroup s dot of x1 plus s dot of x2. So that is the part, finer part here. Each piece is contained inside either in x1 or in x2, and then you are taking the sum total of that, so it will be inside this one. The original thing, you know, part of it may lie in x1 or part of it may lie in interior of x2. But now, when you have cut down, each piece will be either in x1 or x2. So its sum total will be the sum of these two chain complexes. Thus, if tau is a singular n chain, okay, then what is a singular n chain? It is the sum of, so sum of summation ni sigma I. Finite sum. For each sigma I have a ki, right? So you take the maximum for all these ki's. On that k, when you take that many subdivisions, each of the parts will be either here, there is a sum of these two. Therefore, SD of the chain itself now, chain is sum of these things. Okay? Tau is a chain, SDK of tau itself will be inside this one. Of course, this case is not the same as this one k. There is some other k. Okay. So you can take the maximum of all the ki's where each ki is for corresponding sigma I, that does it. Okay. So this stk of tau is an element of x1, x2. This implies, or say always, this is an obvious thing because of the all canonical thing, that's boundary. Boundary is what? Boundary is some summation of various things subjected to or restricted to the boundary. The image will be always in x1 or x2. So therefore, image is also, this boundary is also inside x1 and x2. So that is not a problem. Further, note that SD and capital D, D was the chain map, chain homotopy. Okay, the chain group map, the chain group S1, SX2, they are always, once you are inside X1 and X2, X1 or X2, SD will be also inside X1. So it will never change the bond, codomain of those things. So they are always respecting subspaces. So if something is from S1 plus SX2, it will be always in SX1 plus SX2. Okay, and ST induces identity homomorphism on the homology. Okay, because this is already there. In particular, for any cycle tau in SX1 plus SX2, SD of K of tau and tau represent the same element in HX. If you already inside SX1 plus SX2 and taking a SD of K, representing the same element, because of tau is a cycle, this will be a cycle, and homology elements will be the same. This much we have seen for each capital SD of C. By repeating it k times, this will be true for this also. Therefore, given an n cycle in SX, there is a k in n such that SDK of tau is in SX1 plus SX2. Okay, this much we have seen. Now pass it to homology, phi of this one, phi is just inclusion map, will be tau because these two represent the same element. So this element represents the same element as this one. So this proves surjectivity of phi. Okay, after cutting down, it is this one, this one. Essentially, all this is built up in the idea when you take a path and write it as composite of two of its parts. You cut a path into two parts, two paths, then you take it as a composite. So the two composition of those two, you know, path composition represents the same chain element up to chain equivalence. This is what we have seen long, long back. Okay, so that theme is used always here in a much more strong sense. Okay, so these are all technical details here, that's all. Now, to prove the injectivity is also similar, suppose we prove the injectivity, suppose tau is any n cycle in the SX1 plus SX2 itself, and alpha is an n plus 1 chain in SX such that boundary of alpha is tau. Okay. What I mean by this one, you have started with an element here. Okay. When you go to the larger thing, it represents a zero element. Okay, it's boundary. In the homology, it is represents a zero element. I want to show that it is boundary inside this SX1 plus SX2 inside this submodule. That's all I have to do, right? So this again, for large k, SD of this alpha now, applied to alpha, that will be inside SX1 plus SX2. And the boundary of SD of alpha is nothing but SD of the boundary of alpha. And boundary of alpha is tau, is SD of k. Okay, therefore, tau is 0 in HX1 plus SX2 because tau, the bracket tau is the same thing as bracket SD of tau, STK of tau, but that is the boundary. So this proves the injectivity. Okay, so most of these things are very easy and becomes tautology, but you have to develop these terminologies and concepts, and each concept is very simple. So those simple things you have to verify all the time. So this completes the proof of the big theorem, namely excision theorem. The people are afraid of that, but this is very simple. Okay. So next thing is not all that simple. Okay, little more technical details are here. The next thing is you take a simplicial complex K and a subcomplex L, take the relative singular chain complex. Take the relative singular simplicial chain complex, that is a subcomplex. The inclusion map is a chain homotopy covalence. That was the statement of theorem 4.1. We are supposed to prove this, but we shall not prove this statement itself, but slightly a weaker statement, which will be the more useful for us, I mean more central to us, namely induced map on the homology is an isomorphism. So we shall be satisfied with the proof of this statement 40 here. Okay. The actual statement, the proof of actual statement, this one will come in two steps. Namely, first of all, instead of k comma l, k mod k comma l prime, I will just prove it for the pure thing here, right? Absolute thing here. But once you have done this one, it will be true for L also, right? Once you prove for these two things, it's inclusion map, they are both of them. You can put a long homology exact sequence for the chain complex for S dot of K comma L and H and S of K comma L. Okay, so in the ladder of this long exact homology sequences, each, two of the arrows will be isomorphisms. The third arrow, you don't know. Again, two are isomorphisms and so on. So out of the five of them, you will have the middle one, you don't know. The other two here, two on the other side, they are isomorphisms. By the five lemma, it will follow that the middle one is also an isomorphism. The middle ones are precisely the relative things. Okay, so once you prove it for absolute thing, relative thing follows. So you can just concentrate on this one. Don't worry about the relative part. Okay. After that, the original statement about homology equivalence comes by another general statement on, homological algebra on arbitrary chain complexes, which are free chain complexes. If you have a chain map of free chain complexes, which induces isomorphism homology, okay, then it must be a chain equivalence. So that statement is purely homological algebra. It is not at all difficult, but time consuming. Therefore, I am skipping it. Okay. So, in principle, I am only going to prove this part now. Statement 40. So, another simplification. You want to prove homology isomorphism, you can do that by first proving it only for the finite case. K is finite. Then, usually, you can take a direct limit argument, and then the proof will be true for all K. Indeed, you don't need direct limit as strong as you want if you don't understand it. It's very simple, just like we did it for just now, Paris-Inter and so on. What you have to do? Suppose you want to prove this one. So you want to prove surjectivity, take a chain here. Every chain, every actually cycle here, representing in homology element, every chain is supported on a finite simple chain complex. So there will be a subcomplex here which will contain that. Okay. So instead of K, you use that subcomplex, say K prime. Then from K prime here, S dot of K prime to that one, you have already proved it is surjective. And go to the inclusion map into this one because everything is inclusion map here, inclusion induced map. So that will be surjective. Similarly, suppose some homology, some cycle here becomes trivial here. Okay, what is it trivial? It is a boundary of something. The boundary is a chain. The chain and boundary of that I have taken. Again, that is supported on a finite simple chain complex. You take that simple chain complex. So there you have already proved that if this is 0 here, it is 0 here itself. 0 here means what? There is a boundary here. So that will be the same thing as in the larger one. So if even if you don't know direct limits and so on, as much as of course we have done it very thoroughly, but direct limit in the cohomology case can be done by this method, that's all. But it's easy to remember what is happening for finite ones. You take the direct limit for homology. Okay, homology commutes the direct limits here, so it will be proved. For each finite typical complex isomorphism, for every K it will be isomorphism. Now, so how do we prove it for finite simplicial complex? Here we use induction. Induction on the number of simplexes inside K. If the number is 1, what is K? K has to be a singleton vertex, that's all. For a singleton vertex, both SS of singleton and S of singleton, they are what? They are identical. Okay, every map and from delta into single vertex is simple shell already. They are identical, so this is an isomorphism. For K equal to 1, for R equal to 1, the statement is obvious. Now you assume that it is true for all simple shell complexes which total number of symplexes is less than r, and r is some positive number. Okay. K is a finite simplicial complex, therefore there is always a maximal simplex. Maximal means what? It is not contained in another larger simplex. Okay, so let S be a maximal simplex. Now delete that maximal simplex only. So suppose S is V naught, V1, Vn. You don't put V naught, V1, Vn, that is an N simplex. Okay, you delete that, means rest of them you have to keep, namely all the boundary of V of this S will be there. Okay, so only one simplex you will be deleting. Okay, so let L be the subcomplex of K consisting of all simplexes in K other than S itself. And by induction hypothesis, what happens now? The inclusion map from S star of L to S star of SL, this is an isomorphism because it has smaller number of simplexes. Not only that, the same inclusion map, if you restrict it to the S dot is what? The boundary of whatever you have deleted S. That is already inside L. So this S dot is inside L, that also restrict to an isomorphism here. Okay, so this is also induction hypothesis, that this is also an isomorphism. Here S dot denotes the boundary of simplicial complexes, simplexes. We also know that both H star of, this is the boundary of simplicial complex, and H star of S of Sn. Okay, this is simplex itself. Okay, this vanishes in positive dimensions. Okay, this we have seen as particular argument. The homology of delta n, that this is a simplex. Okay, this is a contractible thing. So this is trivial, we have known, except the zero dimension, it is infinite cyclic. In the positive dimension, it is zero. This is also true, this is also contractible. This part we have directly proved in example 2.4. Okay, so they are zero in the positive dimension, and identity, this H naught to H naught, this is just number of components in both sides. This is an isomorphism always. It's actually identity isomorphism. Okay, since any pair K1, K2 of subcomplex of a simple complex is excessive. This we have seen for singular and simplicial chains. Okay, for both simplicial and singular chains, we have seen these excessive couples. Okay, we get, now we can apply Mayer-Vitre sequences. Okay, I can write the homologies for these smaller things as, you know, on K1 and K2. Okay, so here we are using the, what are we using here, tell me, we are using the excision theorem, okay, for K1 and K2, which we have already proved earlier. Okay, we get two corresponding Mayer-Vitre sequences like this. Okay, so this is for L union S, all right, and singular homology. Okay, so sorry, this is for simplicial singular homology. I have put a hat here. This is not twiddle, this is hat. It's just a notation. Temporary notation, because this is large, and if I put that one, it will go out of the slide. That's all. So this is the first row is here, is the for a simplicial, and the second row is a singular. Okay, so this is the union, this is the intersection, this is one of the S dot to something, is Hn of S a chain of model is a union here. So this K is a union, this is a direct sum, this is the intersection. This must be something more here which is missing. Okay, what should be this one? A chain minus one of S direct sum S dot here. Yeah, this merit sequence after all. Union K, K prior had to come, there is no problem. But remember what we have got here. This is this plus this. So this is an isomorphism. This is an isomorphism. This is an isomorphism because of the induction hypothesis. Okay, this is an isomorphism and this is an isomorphism. So only thing that we don't know is this one. But that will be an isomorphism by phi lambda. That's all. So we have one more thing here. Equivalence of singular simplicial and simplicial homology. S dot, S double S and C. C is the simplest singular homology, the simplicial homology. So that also you have to see. Here, this time we don't have inclusion map, but we have quotient map. Okay, we shall present a proof of 4.2 now. For this, just for the proof of that, we would better do it with a total order on the vertices of K. Then for each n simplex sigma, we can display it by writing vi naught vi n in the increasing sequence. Vi, I naught, I1, In are increasing because I have taken one single order on the vertices. Okay, Vi naught will occur before Vi1 and so on. That is the meaning of this. So that will define a unique element of Sn of k. Okay. The Sn of k includes all the simplicial maps, right? So this is one simplicial map. 0 going to Vi naught, 1 going to in E naught, even En going to correspond to Vi naught, Vin. So once you have that, this assignment extends linearly, defines a splitting of Cn of k into Sn of k. See, this is an element of Cn of k. These are generators here. And this is some element here. This is too large. Okay, actually, we have defined Cnk as a quotient of Sn of k. To define the splitting here, we need to have a order. That map, I am calling it as alpha n. Splitting means what? It's a quotient map here. You come back by quotient map, it's identity. The quotient map is far phi from Sn of k to Cn of k. Okay. So if you put all these alpha n's together, okay, that is the totality of this one. That is a chain map. And that chain map follows because of the uniqueness of this, you know, unique simplex and so on. From C dot factor to S dot of k. The chain map verification is not difficult. Such that it's phi composite alpha. Identity of CK, this is just that it is splitting. That is the meaning of splitting. Okay. So we have a splitting which is chain map. Okay. So that is the first thing to observe. Now it remains to define a chain homotopy on the opposite side. See, phi composite alpha is identity already. Alpha composite phi is not identity, but I want to say it's chain homotopic to identity of the bigger complex. If you define chain homotopy, then this alpha star will be the inverse of phi star. So we wanted to prove that phi star is an isomorphism. So that will be over. So how to prove, how to define a chain homotopy from alpha composite phi to आइडेंटिटी ऑफ एस के. तो बोथ फी एंड आल्फा प्रिजर्व सब कॉम्प्लेक्सिस ऑफ के. इन अदर वर्ड्स, इफ यू हैव सब कॉम्प्लेक्स हियर, फी ऑफ दैट विल गो इन साइड सी एन ऑफ दैट सब कॉम्प्लेक्स. सिमिलरली इफ के इज सब कॉम्प्लेक्स ऑफ एल, से एल इज सब कॉम्प्लेक्स ऑफ के, सी एन ऑफ एल विल गो इन टू एस एन ऑफ एल. दीज आर ऑल कैनोनिकल थिंग्स हियर. ओके, सो दोज थिंग्स आर इजी टू वेरीफाई. सो सब कॉम्प्लेक्स नेमली एल इज सब कॉम्प्लेक्स ऑफ के, पी ऑफ एस एल इज सी ऑफ एल, alpha of CL is S of L. The chain homotopy that we are going to construct will also have this property that it will preserve the subcomplexes. Hence, we can easily pass on to relative chain complexes. So, relative version will also come automatically, is what I wanted to emphasize here. Okay, so anyway, so we have defined this chain homotopy H. Chain homotopy means what? It is a map from Sn to Sn plus 1 homomorphisms, so that this boundary composite H plus H composite boundary is the difference, alpha composite phi minus identity. This is the way H has to be defined. As usual, in many other cases we have seen, we will do this by induction on N. Okay, the first thing is alpha naught. Alpha naught from C naught of K to S naught of K, okay, is the identity map. What is S naught of K? Zero delta naught to anything. There is only unique maps, right? Where it goes, which vertex it has to take, that's all. It is the C naught of K is also same thing. So C naught of K and S naught of K is identity. The quotient map is identity. So alpha naught is identity. Therefore, there is no problem at this level. We can start with H sigma equal to 0 for all zero simplexes. Okay, at the zero level, that's zero simplex level, zero skeleton level, H sigma also can be taken as. Now suppose we have defined H from Sn minus 1 of K to Sn minus Sn of K, so that this is true. Okay, then we have to define it on Sn to have the same property in the next stage. Okay, this is the induction hypothesis. And such that for each n minus 1 singular simplex K, the support of H sigma is contained in the support of sigma. So why I am saying that? I want to construct it this way. So that is a part of the induction hypothesis, so that it will help me to prove the next step. At the induction, H sigma is zero, so here there is induction hypothesis is obvious. Okay, so I will assume I have constructed it in this way, namely, all the singular n simplex sigma, H sigma will be contained in the support of sigma. Okay. Now let tau be any singular n simplex in K. Okay. So remember, we have defined H on only the generators here. Okay. Then we take linear combinations, extend it linearly. So we are talking only about what is happening on the generator. The both sides here are linear. Therefore, if you verify this identity over the generators, then it will be verified for all of them. Okay. So let tau be any singular n simplex in K and S equal to support of tau. Okay, we need to find an n plus 1 chain H tau supported on the same S, and such that H of dava tau. You see, what we are defining here is H, right, in the next stage. So H of this dava of this part, this is already defined. So you take it on the other side. It's alpha composite phi minus tau minus H of dava tau. The dava tau is one dimension lower thing. H of that is already defined. So the left and right hand side here is already defined. Okay, and we want to define H here. It's a dava of this one is this one. So this is possible only if this entire thing is dava of something. Right? So you have to show that this left hand side, right hand side is actually dava of something. It's in the image of dava. Now that is all one has to show. Okay. Obviously, it is necessary that the chain on the RHS of the above equation must be a cycle. If dava of that is zero, then there is a chance. Then it can be dava of something. Right? If it's a dava of something, dava of that will have to be zero. So it must be a cycle first of all. So, okay, that is, if you take dava of this thing, I am taking dava of alpha composite phi minus tau minus H of dava tau. What is this? It is alpha of phi of dava tau, right? This dava is commuted, is by definition, it is alpha phi of dava tau minus dava tau, whatever, minus dava of H of dava tau. Okay. Now, why this is zero? This is by the induction step. So that we have already this equation on 45, on 42. Okay. So, you have to verify that one. It's also clear that the support of this cycle is contained inside us. Okay, we are not going out of a singular simplex X at all completely. Since the homology of Hn of S of delta Q is zero, the whole thing is in a single singular simplex, and any cycle which you have shown cycle is what is trivial, it's a boundary. So finally, this is where we have used topology. Till then, all the time, we are using just, you know, algebra in some sense. So this is an example that we have already done in the case of S of delta Q is zero in positive dimension. So we are already in the high one dimension higher. In the positive dimension, we are argued it in different way. So it follows that this cycle is a boundary, and hence there is a chain H tau belonging to Sn plus 1 of X, but S is containing Sn of K, satisfying our requirement. Mainly dava of that is equal to this one. Okay, so this, because this is first of all it's a cycle, but the cycle is inside S, therefore it is zero in the homology, which means it is the boundary. Okay, so that completes the construction of H and completes the proof of that singular simplicial chain complex is equivalent to the simplicial chain complex itself. Okay, the methods employed here, there is a pattern, and that pattern is generalized to what is called as methods of acyclic models. Something is free, something is acyclic, this acyclicity. These two things will be put together. Okay. My idea is to explain these things in the rudiment of this, in atomic things, in the simplest case, how these things work, so that if you learn more algebraic topology, then you have to learn these higher machineries wherein, you know, neither the books nor the authors nor a teacher will have any time or patience to explain. That's why I've explained all these things separately here instead of using a high machinery right in the beginning. Okay? So this completes us one aspect of whatever you wanted to study, namely the homology. Okay? Whatever we have aimed up till here, that we have completed. So we have completed all the results long back. Now, whatever statements that we have postponed, most of them we have completed proofs, except things like this homological algebra here that I told you. So except for a few things like this, wherein clear reference has been also given, we have completed all the proofs. Okay, so next time we'll take a different topic, namely topology of manifolds. Thank you.